in the entire world. It comes after an outstanding 6.6% economic growth projected and achieved for 2015. While our projections for 2016 are positive and strong, I want us to give God thanks because some of our neighboring islands, for example, Barbados and Trinidad and Tobago, have had recently to impose austerity measures to mitigate negative developments in their economies. Barbados, for example, recently introduced a cell phone tax, and Trinidad and Tobago, you would be aware, is now dealing with issues related to adjustment of its property and other taxes as countervailing measures to deal with anticipated significant loss in their revenue, in part due to the changing fortunes with respect to oil. So while these CARICOM neighbors are doing these austerity measures, the competent management of the fiscal affairs by the Team Unity Administration led us to an outstanding surplus in 2015. For 2016, where will the growth come from? And we say the growth will come from construction, which continues to be very buoyant. And up to year-end, the last quarter results would have shown that we were doing exceptionally well. Tourism, manufacture, agriculture, we expect improved performance, and of course, the professional and financial services. Why should we be concerned about growth? This is an important matter because a growing economy should provide more jobs. A growing economy is what it takes to provide the greater revenues for the government to build a Bastia High School, to establish an oncology unit for the treatment of cancer patients, to renovate the Mary Charles Hospital, as we are about to do, to pay increments to civil servants and wage increases of 3% for an overall 5% burden on the payroll of the government in 2016. It is this growth in the economy that will help us to renovate the former John Gumbs building at the Treasury and the Treasury building. And of course, without these additional revenues, we will be handicapped as far as our expectation to provide more medication for our hospitals and dispensaries. In other words, economic growth in a well-managed economy must trickle down to the better quality of life for all. And indeed, last year, when we experienced a 6.6% growth, what happened to jobs, which we say is a critical part of our prosperity agenda? That growth rate allowed us to hold on to some 24,677 jobs over the period January to October, as against 24,560 in 2014. That growth facilitated an average of $72.32 million in wages and salaries being pumped into the economy each month. And this was up 7% over the 67.5 million per month, an average over the comparative period in 2014. Perhaps the most heartening from the wages data from the Social Security is that we are off to a good start in realizing the enhanced quality of life for all of our people. The results would indicate that prosperity for all is a work in progress, and we are doing relatively well. I want to quote from the document under the caption Wage Distribution, and it says, the comparative analysis with respect to earnings revealed that the earnings landscape has changed for the better. We saw that the distribution of persons earning in the lower wage categories declined, while those earning in the higher wage categories increased. More people earning more. Thus, we may posit that the wage distribution has improved and persons are enjoying higher wages in this term than in the previous term. The document goes on to say, we saw a move from 31% of the jobs paying in the minimum wage category in 2014 to 26% of the jobs paying at the minimum wage in 2015. There were corresponding increases in the medium earning categories for 2015. Now 34% of the people were earning over $3,000 per month as opposed to 31 in 2014. So more people are moving higher. And we are taking people away from the bottom at the minimum level and pushing them in advanced places along the continuum of wages in the country. The obvious conclusion from the data is that our people were better off in 2015 than in 2014. Earnings were higher for the majority, and added to this fact is that food and non-alcoholic beverages declined by 10.6% according to the price index available to the Ministry of Finance over the period January to October 2015. And indeed, we shall see when we examine the report from the IMF that the IMF has said that inflation for St. Kitts and Nevis in 2015 was negative 2%. And it attributed it, critically important, to our removal of VAT and, of course, the reduction in energy prices, which is a global outcome. So there is both the internal data and the external data, external people providing the information, all of them coming to the same information. The purchasing power of all consumers had improved in 2015 as a result of our taxation policy, and life has been made better for the poor. And when you add this to the fact that we had indicated in an early press conference that the number of self-employed and new businesses were increasing in the first half, and indeed for the first 9 months of 2015, you get an indication of what we mean about trickle-down economics and how important it is that the prosperity be shared. You add the unexpected bonanza, over 1,700 former sugar workers having benefited from just around $11 million out of the $16 million that we had received to settle the injustice to these former sugar workers. The majority of the persons who are yet to be paid are really persons who had claimed on behalf of deceased persons, and therefore the time-consuming mechanism of going through the court system, dealing with the absence of will in many cases, that is what is keeping the process, as it were, still a work in progress rather than completion at this date. And you would be aware that one of the last pieces of legislation we took to the Parliament was the Small Estates Act, and that was to assist the mechanism by quantifying a number of the, well, removing what is considered small from 5,000 to, I think, about 25,000, therefore ensuring that the majority of the payments under this program could go through a less tedious and less rigorous legal process. And then we should remind you that it was only in December, late in fact, that $18 million, as it were, out of nowhere, but coming truthfully from the Bank of Commerce, was pumped into the economy. About 5 million of that, of course, came to the government coffers as a result of our deposits in the Bank of Commerce. In 2016, we expect to see continuing progress at Koi Resort, at Park Hyatt, at Embassy Suite, et cetera, et cetera. And I say this so that people could understand the reality of what is happening on the ground. And the reality is that this is creating work for a lot of people. I was recently made aware that the Telegraph, just this weekend, I think it was, had some raving reviews about the Belmont Farm property in St. Kitts, which we refer to more popularly as the Kittishan Hill Project. Belmont Farm was ranked among the top 50 hotels in the world. And so that story is in the Telegraph newspaper that will do good for our tourism product in the UK and European market. I should report that the U Lounge, one of the new additions to our high-end product in tourism, has reported that 2015 has been an exceptional one in terms of the record number of passengers that they were able to receive. You add that good story to the fact that just last week, I think it was, around the 15th and the 16th, the Christophe Harbour held what we call the Crewfest event, the Caribbean Crew Experience 2016, and they brought over 100 crew members from 10 mega yachts to St. Kitts to have a spectacular experience in our federation and therefore put them in better stead to promote St. Kitts and Nevis as an alluring yachting destination. According to the Christophe Harbour people, this was the largest number of yachts they have experienced for any one period. According to them, we are at the cusp of a new high level of growth and development. In the manufacturing sector, there has been some challenges, some of which were captured in the budget address last year. Some decline, marginal as it is. A decline is never a positive news, but we are happy to report that Harris Server in Sandy Point is undergoing expansion work, and that should lead to another 50 permanent jobs at that plant. That is significant because, again, going to the data from the Social Security, it would show last year that we lost about 40 jobs in the manufacturing sector. So when you have one plant being able to bring on 50, this means a significantly positive development. I want to make the point that the prosperity is real, and yet it will not come by osmosis. It therefore requires us that we be disciplined and that we do our very best to achieve it. We have to, as a people, eliminate mediocrity and underperformance from our mindset. In other words, we have to have a new culture of high performance, and that must become the modus operandi. The talk which Charles Wilkin will sometime give about productivity becomes germane here because it means our people must do more, and they must do more from what they have. We, the contractors, have to deliver in a much more convenient time periods. We have to ensure that everywhere we go across the public and private sector, there is genuine value for money. And hence, in my budget address, I made the call for pay per performance as part of a broader concept of performance management, which we must pay attention, not just in the public sector, but also in the private sector. And as we work towards this prosperity pathway, one of the challenges which we face, of course, is the high level of retaliatory violence in the society. The police, the defense force, and all the law enforcement agents must perform better in 2016 than they did in 2015. I think this is a given, and that is the expectation of every rational citizen and resident. And yet, I want to salute those in the law enforcement agency, and there were many, who went beyond the call of duty and to pledge to them this country's fullest support. I want to commend the police and the law enforcement agencies on the production and implementation of the six-point action plan last year around July, and we are encouraged by the results that have been obtained to date. Yet we can't sit on our laurels because the homicide rate and the use of arms in our society is still too high, unacceptably so. In my New Year's address, I articulated the government's intention to address the leadership issue in the police service. And I'm happy to report that we have made substantial progress in that regard. The gazetted officers have been interviewed by a panel with respect to filling positions under a restructured police force with four directorates as per the 2016-2019 strategic plan, which we should formally present to the public in due course. That plan, of course, had been presented to the cabinet, was subjected to cabinet's feedback, and is under review, and once accepted by the cabinet, will then formally form part of the outreach efforts of the police as they engage the critical stakeholder groups and the communities at large in what they can expect for 2016. I am advised that the interviews are now completed and the necessary evaluations and reports are expected shortly. These will form the basis for recommendations relating to the new command of the St. Kitts and Nevis Police Force. These recommendations must be forwarded through the appropriate channels for action. In this regard, it would not be wise for me to speculate on the outcome or to preempt the work, some of which is of a constitutional nature, by entities whose decisions are critical to the appointments. As soon as the formal processes have been exercised, I shall again report to the country on this important matter. So we are hearing a lot of names being tossed here, there, and everywhere. I am not going to engage in that exercise because the way in which the service works is that recommendations comes through the ministry, a recommendation comes, it then goes on to the relevant agency, police service commission, etc., and even up to the governor general before it is formalized and finalized. At any point in the process, those recommendations can be subjected to change. To engage now in those kind of discussions would be preemptive and not helpful to the process. So if people could exercise some level of discipline in relation to that process, it is an important one, and we are trying to do it right. And I should say to you that some of these people and these commissions sometimes take offense when they hear in public matters that should come to them. They are reading them first before they reach them formally and properly. And so that is not something that I, as a minister responsible for the civil service, would want to encourage. But of course, we will urge them to act expeditiously in this critical matter, and we have a time horizon within which we will work with that. Quickly, our efforts at earnings and wealth generation will continue and will expand in 2016 as part of our commitment and the unfolding of our prosperity agenda. You would be aware that we had the Fresh Start program through the assistance from the government of Venezuela and the Development Bank. That provided an initial tranche of $5 million, just around 13 plus million EC, and that went like a frenzy. We were lucky to have the Venezuelan government again advance another 1 million to take the total up to 6 million, so that $16 million were available. just over 200 applicants have been approved and have been paid. The $16 million, therefore, are no more. That again has gone to satisfy the heavy demand in the country by the small and medium-sized entities. And so the government is considering a subvention to the bank to support additional resources to meet a portion of the unsatisfied demands for low-cost financing by small businesses under the Fresh Start program. We can't rely on the commercial banks, for they have not provided it, and they will not provide it, but the government will make up some of the slack. And we want a special tranche targeted directly at weaning persons off the PEP and into high-income earning employment. So whatever we provide to the bank, we will say X amount must be reserved for people who are on the PEP and who now are at a position, have a business plan, which says they can move from being a minimum earner to earning their own keep. And we will give special support to that as part of the program for restructuring and reorganizing PEP and taking people from the minimum. The minimum standards are not good enough for re-insane Kitts and Nevis, and help them to get on the path to prosperity slowly and surely. By way of update, the country for the PEP program has paid $167.9 million. That is what the PEP has cost us. And you will recall from the budget presentation where the Minister of Education had made the point that the CDB, in its analysis of the program, had indicated only about 130 persons receive any form of training under that program. 167.9 million, 130 persons exposed to any rudiments of training. I am pleased to report that our efforts to reduce this hugely unsustainable drain on the public purse has borne some fruits. And I want to thank those private sector entities that have responded positively to our urging that they take on their payroll full-time those PEP workers that have been contributing to their businesses for over a year. It is neither fair nor healthy that the government should, through the PEP program, subsidize the payroll of some private entities while some are denied. This creates an unlevel playing field and the development of a parasitic class. Since my budget address on the 15th December 2015, in that short window, 58 employees have been upgraded from the PEP to full-time employment in the private sector. And so I want to thank all those private sector entities that have agreed to move them from PEP, where they were being paid minimally by the government, to now full-time employees receiving higher earnings. Thanks to Team Unity, these former PEP employees will get better wages. They will now have an improved status, including the improved probability of qualifying for loans and visas, which hitherto as a temporary worker under PEP, no serious person was engaged with visa and with respect to loans. I want to say to all the PEP workers in the private and public sectors, that Team Unity will continue to work for you. We want you to do the very best that you can. And those in the public sector could be assured that when vacancies arise, we will give consideration to their permanent placement. But of course, preference will be given to the best of these workers because we want only the best in the public service. And what are some of the yardstick? Punctuality attitude, aptitude, and your responsiveness to service excellence. So if you're on the job and you're working well and you're showing all the desirable attributes, you stand a good chance once a vacancy arises. Remember, part of the commitment to the IMF, and Judith Gold reminded us, was that these people could not become part of the permanent establishment. So you couldn't just go and expand. But if vacancies become available for which they are able and willing to perform, fair consideration is promised to them. So we want them, of course, to continue to give a fair day's work in the expectation of a fair day's pay. And especially those who are involved in the maintenance of our physical environment, we want them to live up and to do well. We still have issues of attitude and discipline in that aspect of the work. We still have persons who do not work or come to work too late and leave too early thereafter and expecting to be paid, and we will not countenance it. We will not allow that kind of waste of the public resource to take place. I want to commend the Permanent Secretary, who has provided leadership over the PEP program, Mr. Osbert D'Souza. But not just him, the entire management and support staff at the PEP program for their very competent oversight of the program since Team Unity has come to office. We are moving in the right direction, and we will reorganize and restructure PEP to make it fit for purpose, providing relevant training and preparation of our young people for the world of work, the world of entrepreneurship, and of course, responsible citizenship. That is important. Having the right graces, the right attitude, the right discipline are part of what we expect from a responsible citizen. And therefore, those values will be pushed on the program. There have, of course, been a lot of conversation regarding the labor laws and illegal persons working in St. Kitts and Nevis. I want to address this at the start of the new year. For as we transition from PEP to permanent jobs for our people, we are reminded that the government must be firm against illegal workers occupying our work sites. We make it abundantly clear that the workplace in St. Kitts and Nevis must reflect predominantly citizens of St. Kitts and Nevis and legal migrants into our country. Citizens and legal migrants, that is where the preference should be. If you're here legally, you have all the rights, of course, and duties, etc., attached. So we make it clear. That is what we are hoping to do. The Ministry of Labor has been tasked to do more monitoring of the construction, tourism, and hospitality sectors to ensure full and faithful compliance with the laws and regulations governing work permits and CARICOM skilled certificates. Our people must never be disadvantaged in the land of their birth. That being said, we accept that we are short in certain skill sets, and that several entities, for example, Marriott, for example, any other, the accounting firms, they are global in nature with policies for cross training and attachment. We understand that, and we understand what that means in terms of the composition of their staff to reflect that global reality. We are not insensitive to these realities, and of course our labor policy accommodates these situations. What we do is that we ask the employers in St. Kitts and Nevis not to be insensitive to the government's policies, and at all costs to operate within the four corners of the law. The Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of National Security, who is here, has informed me that 509 work permits were issued in 2015. In 2014, 773 work permits were issued. The Permanent Secretary has made several recommendations which are to be decided upon by the Cabinet to clamp down on persons working without work permits. For instance, there's a recommendation that there be a penalty for late payments of work permit fees. And this is already in place in Nevis, limiting the number of work permits for entities. You go to some of these, particularly in the retail area, you see really loud, it's too much there. And just your eyesight, you could see what is happening. And so we are looking. That idea is now that we have to kind of have a concept, a notion of how many any entity should have. And of course, we are prepared to revoke work permits that are not in compliance with the local laws. And the local laws tell you certain things. You have to advertise consecutively for 3 weeks, et cetera, and you have to show that there's no local person able and willing to do the job at the pay offered. So once we find a work permit has been issued under false pretense, the power to revoke that will be exercised. And we will establish a system for better coordination between the Labor Department, PEP, Social Security, and National Security. We ask all people, employers in particular, to comply with the Immigration Act. The Immigration Act, in fact, states that a person shall not engage or employ another person who is not a citizen or resident unless a work permit is granted. And it imposes penalties, fines, and imprisonment for the breach of the Act. The question is, are we prepared to go all the way to enforce the law? And the answer is yes, Team Unity will, on behalf of the people. There was no greater motivator for unity between PLP, PAM, and CCM than the good governance agenda, to which I now turn. And we would recall that the megalomaniac hold and power by the Douglas administration brought democracy to a screeching halt. Lest we forget, for nigh 26 months, Denzel Douglas defied the parliamentary opposition, the Chamber of Industry and Commerce, churches and the people, and he used every ruse he could think of to prevent the tabling of the motion of no confidence. The protracted court matter costs our country several million dollars, and we are still tabulating. Indeed, this matter is still before the court, so additional cost is still to be borne by the people. We are committed to a broad agenda of reform, and the reforms will fall broadly of the type we may consider constitutional reform. We, for example, have already tabled the first reading of the bill to deal with the tenure in the office of the Prime Minister. But there are other issues which some have put before us. The matter to do with citizenship requirements for people to become members of parliament and the related issues of dual citizenship. All those are matters that require constitutional reform. Indeed, we have also been advised that even with respect to the motion of no confidence, whether legislatively or constitutionally, we will need to address that to make stricter requirements regarding adherence to the traditions and reasonable expectations with respect to that matter. Electoral reform is still high on the agenda, and this would, of course, we will start in earnest this year. People are concerned that there is an absence of adequate penalties for electoral officials for serious breach of our electoral laws and behavior that undermine public confidence in the electoral system. And we have issues to do with the eligibility issues of citizens, residents, and our diasporic community. And then, of course, we will deal with issues with respect to expanding the accountability and transparency. Freedom of Information Bill already had its first reading. Data security laws to come. An empowering of the parliament as a pillar of democracy and of government is critical to the accountability framework of this government. In this regard, we will pursue in the near future a new home for the parliament, provide the parliament with appropriate resources to do its work, to produce hazards on a timely basis, and enhanced the role of the clerk of the assembly so as to ensure that that office holder consistently operates at a highly professional and international standard expected of such an office holder. Also to be introduced are functional parliamentary committees to facilitate broad-spectrum legislative consultations prior to bills being introduced into our parliament. These ideas have been advanced before by the Speaker, the Honourable Franklin Brand. I want to say that we feel fortunate to have the services of Mr. Brand at this time. And in that regard, I note recent publicity given to a rumor of Mr. Brand's resignation. Of course, that resignation is yet to be received. And in our view, there was not a scintilla of evidence to such a resignation or pending one. Mr. Brand has served us well so far, attempting to bring a new ethos of responsible behavior to the National Assembly. He was present and he presided over every sitting of the Parliament since his election. He started to preside over the last sitting of the Parliament at which the budget was presented on account of an illness. He did not preside to the end of the budget debate. We were very careful from the outset to ensure that a deputy speaker is in place. The absence then of the Honourable Speaker for any reason does not prevent the Parliament from functioning. Hence, we didn't quite understand the excitement that was being generated about the purported resignation of the Speaker. The Honourable Michael Perkins has acquitted himself very well, according to public opinion, as he deputized last time for the Speaker. Our Constitution certainly never contemplated a breach which was introduced for the first time by the Douglas administration when it blatantly refused to appoint a deputy speaker as per Section 32, Subsection 3 of our Constitution. Team Unity gave a fresh start, and we fulfilled that constitutional requirement. The wisdom of that move, of course, is self-evident. The Parliament can now function even when the Speaker is ill or absent, or indeed, if there were a resignation, the Parliament can still function. There is a deputy. A deputy is essential. Another rumor which has mysteriously surfaced had to do with the purported resignation by the press secretary, who is still here. The press secretary, for the record, always had a one-year assignment with Team Unity, and that one-year assignment will end in the near future, perhaps at the end of February, to be exact, 29th of February. Mr. Clapton Phillip will leave the office of the press secretary by mutual agreement on the completion of the agreed period of service. We will in time determine where best his services can be further utilized. In the meantime, we would wish Mr. Phillip well as he find other avenues for his gifts and talents. Will they be at further service to the public sector or in the private sector? It is a matter for Mr. Phillip to consider. And of course, for us collectively, if it is in the public sector, to be engaged. Would want to record in advance my appreciation for his contribution to the office, the work of the office of the Prime Minister and the country at large. The final matter I want to address is the matter to do with the SIDF. And I am pleased to say that we are advancing to the point where we can say that a new entity will be legislated to perform the activities that hitherto have been undertaken by the SIDF. This new entity, of course, will operate in a restructured and more accountable framework. We expect when the law comes into being and it is being drafted, I had reported last time, by two QCs. We would have wished that they would have completed their work, but again, QCs are high-paid officials and officers, and they are doing this gratuitously at no cost to the government out of love of the country. But they tell us they are nearing the end. We expect that the legislation will ensure that the new entity will have an accountability relationship to the People's Parliament. That was one of the problems we had with the SIDF as constituted. Members of Parliament could not ask the former Prime Minister a question. He said it was a private matter. It had nothing to do with him. That if the people want to answer you, they could choose to answer you. You will have to ask them to do you a favor. Our view has always been against that. That that was an aberration. That that couldn't fly. That the asset that had been part of the business of the SIDF was the people's asset, the people's citizenship, the people's patrimony, and therefore it fell under the realm of public monies, and it ought to have had that accountability relationship with the parliament. One of the other problems that people have had is that the SIDF refused or had become unable to produce annual audited financial statements. The last you may find may be up to 2011, if not 2012. No other statements have been provided. We are now in 2016. We would want to ensure there is conformity with Section 69 of the Constitution regarding the use of public monies. We have heard from one learned QC that the SIDF has now been working, is working in violation, in breach of the Constitution at Section 69. So as part of the fresh start to the restructured entity, we will ensure compliance, conformity with the Constitution. And we will give this new entity a clear scope of work and areas of engagement. This will be one effort to prevent the perfidious and squandermania of the public resources. Well, we know what happened. That SIDF of the past was one that could do any manner of things anytime. It could suddenly develop a reach, it could develop a scope, it could develop a PEP, it could develop roads, it could give monies to Christoph Harbour, it could get an interest in Kittishan Hill. Call anything good or bad, that SIDF could have done that. That is a way that leads to corruption, that leads to problems of governance, and we will ensure that we give the new entity a narrow scope of reference so the councillors know and everyone knows these are what it can do. You can't do all manner of things for everyone, but it serves the political agenda of the past to allow that entity to be able to behave as if it was a Lord, save in every particular situation, save it went into some foul situation. While we are waiting on the law, we have determined that in the interim, we will put a board of councillors in place. Recall last time I had reported that Dr. Robertine Shadderton was acting as the secretary. We have revised that. Through the National Trust, the board has now been put forward by the National Trust, which is the founder, comprises Dr. Robertine Shadderton in a new role of chairperson, Maclure Taylor as counselor, Leanne Lescott as counselor. A secretary is to be appointed. Again, according to the laws governing the SIDF, that person will have to be a service provider. And the board then is working on dealing with that special case. The naming of the board of councillors now provides for the effective management of the SIDF going forward. The pursuance of those activities for which only a board could properly engage. The general public, in my view, wants the board to give priority attention to ensure that the long overdue audited financial statements are available as soon as possible, and to conduct the necessary evaluation of SIDF's involvement in several projects, some of which I've named before, and several other programs and activities, including investigating potential misfeasance or malfeasance by the former Board of Councillors. And we hope that the board would be sensitive to public opinion in relation to these matters.